Good morning, everyone, as you join us again from the comfort of your homes. And this morning we have a special service. It's the Magheramason PW service. And I want to say thank you to all the ladies in the congregation of Magheramason and also Kilfenan. We know there's an ongoing work that goes on there behind the scenes. And it's been a very difficult year for all of the organisations, including the PW. And we thank the ladies in both congregations for all the work that goes on and all the prayers that ascend there from your homes as we continue to remember the work of our ladies in the congregation of Magheramason today. And thank you to everybody who's going to take part later in the service. I want to, on your behalf, give a very warm welcome to Jason from Frontiers Ireland, and he will be sharing today, boys and girls, a children's address for you, and then he'll be sharing a little report on Frontiers and their work, and particularly the Laki people. That's a people group in Iran that we as a church in Magheramason have committed for one full year to pray for, and you'll hear a little update about that particular work later on in the service. Then this evening, please remember our Christianity Explored. That begins this evening at 7 p.m. and there's still time for you to register for that. All you have to do is simply send me your name either through Facebook Messenger or my email, or if you want to lift the phone and contact the manse this afternoon, you'd be very welcome to do that. And if you can't get along this evening, that course, God willing, will run over the next number of Sunday evenings, every Sunday at 7. And there still will be time for you to join in even next Sunday. And we would also encourage, if you can, please encourage your friends. And why not even today invite somebody to come along with you, and from the comfort of their home in Magheramason or in Kilfenan or Port Stewart or Coleraine, wherever they might be. Of course, the beauty of this course is that people can join from near and far. And please pray for this outreach opportunity as we come through the weeks of Lent in the lead up to Easter. Then as we go into our week, please remember the prayer times in both Kilfenan and Magheramason. They continue on Wednesday evening at 8 o'clock on Zoom. And as usual, before that, from 6 o'clock, there'll be a little message. I'm going back into the book of Philippians, chapter 4, and that should be available on the Magheramason and Kilfenan Facebook pages from 6 p.m. on Wednesday. And then into Thursday morning at 10 a.m., we have an additional prayer time. The last Thursday of each month, there's a community prayer time, and we concentrate our prayers on the wider community and the need for revival and for God to come and move through our community. And if you'd like to get involved with that prayer time, again, just contact me and I gladly give you the Zoom number for access to that particular time. And then Kilfenan session, please remember our meeting on Thursday evening, and that's at 7:30, and that's also going to be on Zoom as well. And then, God willing, next Sunday morning, we'll be back again online to worship, and the service will be going out as usual, available from 11:15, and I again hope to be bringing God's Word next Sunday. And as mentioned before, then in the evenings, the Christianity Explored will continue through these weeks. I'm now going to hand over to Mandy to continue from here.
Well, it's lovely to be with you this morning, and we just want to thank Amy for her lovely intro there. As we come to worship God, we think of 1 Samuel chapter 2, which was Hannah's prayer. My heart rejoices in the Lord. The Lord has made me strong. Now I have an answer for my enemies. I will rejoice because you have rescued me. No one is holy like our Lord. There is no one besides you. There is no rock like our God. Let us pray. Almighty God, as we bow before you, we want to thank you for the life of Jesus Christ, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used for his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. For this divine life that he lived, which was full of compassion, ministering to people's needs and showing them the way of life. As we unite our hearts in prayer from our homes, may we even get a small glimpse of your Son's holiness and majesty. We pray you will open our eyes that we might see him afresh. We pray you enlighten our understanding that we may really know him as our Lord and Saviour. We pray you strengthen our wills that we may follow him as he leads and guides. May our inner being be refreshed, purified, cleansed and blessed by this hour of worship. We also commit Jason and his family and the work that you have called him to you, Lord, and we pray that you will bless him and the PW members as they share in the service this morning. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. We will now come and worship together as we sing, Come People of the Risen King. And then the service will be handed over to Jason, who will do the children's address and a report from Frontiers and an update on the Laki people. Then we will have our Bible reading from one of our PW members, Mrs. Iris Smith, and that will be followed by the prayers of intercession, which will be done by the PW president, Mrs. Pamela Davis, and then it'll be handed back to Jason for an epilogue. Thank you.
Oh, joining us in this RPW service. On behalf of the committee, I would like to thank the ladies for all their support over the years, and especially during this year, as we have missed joining together for fun and fellowship because of the pandemic. We do not know when it will be safe to start meeting again, but until that time comes, we will continue to uphold each other in prayer. Hopefully, in the good weather, and depending on the guidance, we might be able to have an outdoor event later in the summer. Please remember, if you're feeling lonely or just fancy a wee chat, please contact any member of our PW. Never underestimate, as well as getting encouragement, you may be an encourager too.
Good morning, boys and girls. How are you? I hope you're all keeping really well. My name is Jason. I know you probably don't recognise me or know me, but I'm going to be speaking to your mummies and daddies a little bit later on today in service. But before then, I wanted to read you a story, if that's okay, from the Bible about a guy that you'll probably have heard of, or maybe some of you will have heard of, called Daniel. And this particular version of the story is called Daniel and the Very Hungry Lions. So we're going to read this story and see what God has to teach us about through it today. This is a true story from the Bible. Some books you just listen to as someone else reads, but this book is different. Every time there is a word on the page that is a sound, you have to try and make that sound yourself. So let's practice the sound that a lion makes. Let me hear your lion noise.
Roar!
That was my son, Daniel.
Yeah.
Now, we're ready to start this true story from the Bible about a man called Daniel, a king called Darius, and some very hungry lions. Every day, the people of Babylon woke up to the sound of the king's roaring, ravenous lions. Roar! Nash, nash. And every day, Daniel got out of bed, went to the window, knelt down, and prayed to God. Daniel loved God and talked to him each and every day. Daniel trusted God and knew that Daniel loved God and talked to him each and every day. Daniel trusted God and knew that he was in control of everything that happened. God had made Daniel wise and clever and honest, and King Darius liked Daniel and put him in charge. But not everyone was happy. Mutter, mutter, plot, plot. Some important men didn't like Daniel. They wanted to get rid of him. Uh-oh. They came up with a clever, clever plan. Oh, great king, you must make a law that can never be broken. Anyone who prays to God must be fed to the ravenous lions.
I'm just trying to talk. Hey, that I can do it when I talk.
Okay. King Darius agreed to these men, and he made a law that could not be broken. What should Daniel do?
I don't know.
Well, Daniel loved God, and Daniel served God, and Daniel knew that God was in control. Think, think, scratch, scratch. He knew that God could be trusted even if he was thrown to the roaring, ravenous lions. So, each day, Daniel went to his window, knelt down, and carried on praying to God. What do you think happened next? Well, the nasty men had Daniel arrested and taken before the king. King Darius was sad because he knew that he had been tricked. He didn't want to feed Daniel to the roaring, ravenous lions, but he had made a law that couldn't be broken. What could he do? King Darius ordered the men to throw Daniel into the den filled with the roaring, ravenous lions. The king said to Daniel, "May the God who you serve save you." And Daniel went thump, 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 thump into the lion's den. A great big stone was put over the entrance and all went quiet. What would the lions do? Oh, King Darius couldn't sleep. He was so worried about Daniel. And he was cross that he had been tricked. Would God keep Daniel safe from the roaring, ravenous lions? What do you think?
I don't know.
Well, just as the sun was rising, King Darius ran to the den. He called out, "Daniel, are you there? Did God save you from the roaring, ravenous lions?" "Yes," called Daniel. "God sent an angel who shut their mouths." The stone was rolled away and Daniel came out alive and well. There was not a single scratch on him. "Now, where are those evil men who tricked me?" said Darius. What would the king do? He ordered his men to throw them into the den. Let me hear your lion roar. Roar, crunch, crunch. And the very hungry lions ate them for breakfast. Oh no. So King Darius learned something important that day. The God that Daniel loves and serves, the God who rescued Daniel from the roaring, ravenous lions, he is the one true God who lives forever. Amen. Well, boys and girls, I hope you enjoyed that story. And as I say, maybe some of you knew that story already. But I wonder, was there one thing that maybe you noticed that Daniel did, both in the good times and in the not so good times? It was a word that began with P. What did he do whenever things were good and when things weren't so good? He prayed, didn't he? Daniel was somebody who loved to pray. And later on, I'm going to talk to your mummies and daddies a little bit about prayer and how important prayer is for all of us. And let me let you into a cool little fact and secret about prayer. You don't have to be really old to pray. You can pray at your age right now. You can speak to God anytime, anywhere that you want to. You can say thank you to him for the sunshine whenever we have it, or the toys that you have, or the food that you get to eat, or your friends and family, or lots of things that we can say thank you to God for. You can ask him for help when you feel a little bit afraid and say, "Lord, I'm a little bit scared of this. Will you give me help and strength? Maybe I'm a little bit nervous about going to school or going back to school at some point. Lord, would you help me in that?" And God just loves it when we come to him to pray. We can be thankful. We can ask for help. We can ask for and say sorry and ask for forgiveness when we've done something wrong. And God just loves it when you and I come to him to pray. So Daniel was somebody who prayed and God heard him, God listened and God helped him. And God can do the same for you and me as we pray as well. So God bless you, and maybe someday I'll get to see you soon. Bye.
From the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 23 to 31. The Believer's Prayer. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. When they heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. "Sovereign Lord," they said, "you made the heaven and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers gather together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform miraculous signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke the word of God boldly. Amen.
It's a real delight to be able to share a bit with you this morning about the work and ministry of Frontiers Ireland, and also to mention a little bit about the Pray for Zero prayer initiative as well, which is an initiative that helps to resource churches to pray for an unengaged Muslim people group. Frontiers as an organisation began back in 1983 with a focus on church planting in the Muslim world. Jesus said 2,000 years ago that the harvest was plentiful, and also that he would build his church, but what is needed are labourers to join him in his kingdom building project across the earth. Today, there are over 1,100 adults serving with Frontiers, that's excluding children, in about 50 different countries, and they come from over 50 different countries as well. And they're involved in all kinds of ministry, from teaching, using skills and trades, medical work, NGOs, business, tourism, creative industries, basically using whatever skills and abilities they have to serve and bless Muslims across the world. Our mission statement is, with love and respect, inviting all Muslim peoples to follow Jesus. And that's the heart of what we're about, to be rooted in God's love, both in our own lives, but also out of that, to love and respect all Muslim peoples and to extend Jesus' invitation to come and follow him for themselves. To give you an idea of where we work, this map will show you some countries in green, and those countries are the ones where we have various workers serving in different capacities, seeking to bless local Muslims who live there. Frontiers Ireland, which is the Irish office serving both the north and south of Ireland, began on St. Patrick's Day 2000 with a desire to see the church across our land informed about what God is doing throughout the Muslim world, and also to partner with churches and individuals to see new workers raised up to go and to bless the nations in the name of Jesus. Over these past nearly 21 years, we have seen God's faithfulness year on year. He sent out 46 workers, excluding children again, into the harvest fields, serving among 16 people groups in 13 different countries. Despite many challenges and hardships at times, the Lord Jesus has been true to his word and used these ordinary people, just like you and me, as they have gone, and he has used them to help build and establish local expressions of his church in places like North Africa and Central Asia, where they previously didn't exist. Not only that, but globally, in the past 21 years, more Muslims have been turning to Christ than in the previous 1400 years since Islam began. So God is truly doing something amazing and unique in our day and generation throughout the Muslim world, and he's inviting us to join him in what he's doing, whether by praying, sending, giving, or going in the name of Jesus. One of the keys to seeing breakthrough in the Muslim world has been an increase in prayer for peoples and places over recent decades. And in 2018, one of the things that we felt led of the Lord to begin was a prayer initiative called Pray for Zero. Along with many other organisations, we identified that as of 2018, there were 179 Muslim people groups, each with populations over 100,000, that were still completely unengaged with the gospel, What does unengaged mean? That means that they have no workers serving among them, there's no church that gathers, and there are few, if any, known believers at all. So we felt God lay a what if question on our hearts. What if 179 churches across Ireland, north and south, adopted an unengaged people group for a year of prayer? What might God continue to do throughout the Muslim world as churches across our land pray for the number of unengaged people groups to reach zero, that all of them would be engaged with the gospel? And what God has done so far has truly amazed us. 74 people groups have now been adopted for a year of prayer by churches across Ireland, and a few from England and Holland have joined in as well. There have been 71 people groups from the original 179 who were previously unengaged in 2018, and they have now become engaged with the good news of Jesus. And 22 churches who have prayed for a people group have seen their people group become engaged, which is just so encouraging. In total, there have been 123 people groups which have been uniquely impacted since Pray for Zero began, which means that they've either been adopted for prayer or they've become engaged with the gospel. So praise God that He is moving in power. Not only are churches being raised up to pray, but people are being raised up to go as well. And can I just say, on behalf of Frontiers, we are so grateful that you as a church are a part of this Pray for Zero initiative, that you've adopted the Laki people of Iran and are committing to pray for them. And we are so, so grateful to you as a church for doing that and taking up this challenge to pray for the Laki people for a year. The Laki are a Kurdish people numbering 1 million, and they're located in the mountainous southwest region of Iran. They follow the Shia branch of Islam, as most people in Iran do, and they have no written scriptures available in their language, although they do have some audio scriptures available. It's hard to imagine that the Laki people, which number more than half the population of Northern Ireland, have no church at all, no workers serving among them, and few, if any, believers in Christ. But what we do know is that, as Revelation 7:9 says, there will be people from every tribe and nation and language praising Christ before the throne of God in that final day, and that will include a representation of the Laki of Iran too. So your prayers are sowing into and investing in what God is doing and yet to do among these people that He so dearly loves and for whom Christ died. For the nation of Iran, you may also be aware that despite being a Muslim-majority country, it has one of the fastest-growing churches in the world, despite much persecution as well. So God is certainly on the move in Iran, and your prayers for this people and this nation are coming at a very timely moment in its history. So may the Lord bless you as you pray for this people group using the 30-day prayer guides that you've received. And may the Lord hear you, hear all of your prayers, and bring His love and saving grace to many Laki hearts as a result of your prayers. God bless you all.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, on this our PW service, we thank you for every good gift you have given us. Father, we thank you that you sent your Son to be our Saviour and Lord. We have so much to praise you for, Father. Help us in the middle of all the stresses and pressures of life to find your peace and joy, and have praiseful hearts that have made room for you. May we grow side by side in our faith and be able to show in our lives that we belong to you. We bring before you the work of Presbyterian Women here in Magheramason, in our presbytery, in Church House, and across the world. We pray for the staff in Church House, as there is a lot of uncertainty in these days. We pray for all members of PW who feel isolated and lonely in these strange times. We live on your promise that you will never leave us nor forsake us. We think of our missionaries and deaconesses as they work for the advancement of your kingdom. For the PW Mission Fund and special projects for this year, the community work in Nepal, the work of CareNI, let all those who come into contact with these projects know your presence with them. Lord, watch over our churches in Magheramason and Kilfenan. Even though we are unable to meet together physically, we are still able to walk side by side, spiritually and emotionally, feeling your presence from our homes. For our minister, the Reverend Orr, who faithfully teaches and preaches your word to us, strengthen and guide him. We pray for our health service, for those who work on the front line. Give them the strength to continue in the care of those suffering from all illnesses, COVID or other. Grant wisdom to those in government that they will make the right decisions that would bring honour and glory to your name. Lord, bring revival to your land that people may see you are the way, the truth and the life, the great I am. We ask that you would bless our Christianity Explore course that starts tonight on Zoom, that people would take the opportunity to get to know you more. We bring before you all those in our church families who are ill or have suffered a bereavement. We ask that you would give them strength, healing and comfort in the days ahead. We pray for all families who are struggling with balancing work, homeschooling and family life. Grant them grace and patience as they take each day as it comes. We think of the children and young people as they miss seeing their friends at all the church organisations. Let them know your presence with them, always. Help them to enjoy the many online resources they can use to learn more about you. Lord, we pray for Jason and the work with Frontiers Ireland as they seek to reach all peoples with your word. We bring before you the Laki people from Iran. May they know the joy of having you as their saviour. As Jason brings your word to us, open our hearts and minds that we would hear you speak to each one of us. We ask all these things in your precious name. Amen.
Thank you.
Again, just remember, if you can, leave from the back, just row by row.
It's a real privilege to be with you this morning, or whenever you're getting a chance to watch this, and to be able to share something from God's Word from Acts chapter 4. I remember with fondness being able to meet some of you at the prayer meeting a couple of months ago, I think back in November time it was. And I'm sorry that we can't be together face to face and in person today, but hopefully that will happen again sometime. For now, it just has to be this screen, as is most of our lives these days. But my theme for this talk is simply the praying church. And I'm sure you'll agree that one of the core characteristics of the believers in the early church was that they were a praying people. They were people who prayed anywhere and everywhere. It was just part of their DNA. It was part of who they were. And I think that this passage in Acts chapter 4 that was read for us gives us some insights into their praying lives as people, as a church. And I think that it offers us some encouragement and ideas even for how we can continue to be a praying church in our generation as well and see God move in response to our prayers. So I just wanted to share four quick things about prayer that jumped out to me from the passage. And I hope and pray that it encourages you in your prayers, particularly this year, as you pray for an unengaged people group. Just before I begin to mention these four things, I wanted to say that what really encourages me as I read this passage is that prayer is the first thing that the believers did when they heard the message and the report from Peter and John. I once heard somebody say recently, let prayer be your first response rather than your last resort. And truthfully, that's something that I can sometimes struggle with. I sometimes try to do stuff a bit in my own strength first and then maybe bring prayer in down the line. But I really want prayer to be my first response rather than my last resort. And I pray that it will be yours this year as well as you pray more and more. So the first thing to note about the praying life of the early church was that they prayed informed prayer. Informed prayer. Peter and John had just been put in prison temporarily on account of this paralyzed man who had been healed, and it was this incredible miracle. Very bold about that it was done in the name of Jesus, and they'd been temporarily imprisoned. They had been threatened by the religious leaders at the time and then released. And chapter 4, verse 23 of Acts says that they went back to their people. They reported all that the chief priests and elders had said to them. And then in verse 24, it says, when they, that is the gathering of people, heard this, they raised their voices together in prayer to God. In other words, the prayer flowed immediately out of hearing this report of all that had happened to Peter and John. It was the latest up-to-date information from real people that led them to pray in a specific and informed way. And that's kind of like how we all respond, isn't it? If we respond well to a story or to a person, someone who shares their heart, someone who shares something, really helps us to be able to pray more specifically and more informed way for them. And this is partly why Pray for Zero has a specific bespoke prayer guide for each people group in order to help churches mention people groups specifically by name and pray in an informed way for them and for their country. I think that when we get informed about anything, whether it's a global situation or an issue closer to home, it helps us to pray in a more meaningful and connected way. And that was certainly something that the early believers did. They prayed informed prayer. The second thing to note was that the prayer of the early church was united prayer. I love what it says in verse 24. It says that they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Sovereign Lord, they said. And it goes on. It sort of sounds like it's one person praying, but yet it's saying that they were all kind of praying in unison and in unity of heart. So it wasn't just one person or a few of them. They were all kind of praying this together. They were united in their prayer. And this resonates with what's mentioned in Acts 1, verse 14, where it says they all joined together constantly in prayer. And we know, of course, that Jesus himself said that even if two or three are gathered together in his name, that there he is in the midst of them. So there is real power and blessing that comes from God when we unite our hearts as well as our prayers together in Christ. And my hope and my prayer for you, for my own life and our church and everything, is that despite this season of social distancing, that somehow by the Holy Spirit of God, He would bring a togetherness in your praying life as a church. I think the PW theme was or is side by side. And I guess it's my prayer that we would have a side by side praying life, side by side with God first and foremost, and then also side by side with one another to create this unified heart of prayer and intercession. The third thing to note about the praying of the early church is that they prayed about earthly problems, but they prayed about them in light of eternal truth. They prayed about earthly problems in light of eternal truth. It wasn't that the threats to Peter and John weren't real, they were. And we know that as Acts goes on that Peter would be in prison again, and Peter and John and others would be persecuted, some would be killed. So the threats were really, really real. And it wasn't also that this report wouldn't really impact the gathering of people who were there, because as the gathering of God's people, of Jesus' followers, it very well could impact them as well. And while they didn't diminish the reality of the earthly problems, the challenges that existed, they prayed about these very real issues by framing them in the light of who God was and placing Him and His power above it all. In verse 24, they praise God for His sovereignty and His lordship, for being the creator of all things. In verse 25, they praise God for being a God who speaks by the Spirit through Scripture and through ordinary people. And verse 28 says that they acknowledge God's power and will to work salvation through the death of Jesus. And then it was in light of all of this wonderful eternal truth about God that in verse 29 it says, "Now, Lord, consider their threats." They prayed about real issues, they didn't diminish them, but they prayed about them in light of God's majesty, God's greatness and bigness. And as churches pray for people groups that are yet to even hear about the good news of Jesus, it can and it probably will feel a bit overwhelming at times. There's vast areas of the world that and people groups that still have little or no knowledge of the gospel. And that can leave us wondering, are we really going to see a tangible difference? Will our prayers really have an impact on these people? And yet, if and as we pray in light of God's bigness and greatness rather than the bigness of the challenge that still remains, maybe faith will stir in us, rise up in us in a fresh way, and cause us to pray for the seemingly impossible. Perhaps God will give us fresh insight into His word as we pray through it on behalf of the Laki people. And perhaps the challenge that remains won't seem quite as daunting as we remember and pray in the name of Jesus, for whom nothing is impossible. And the fourth and final thing that I wanted to note about the praying lives of the early church was that it was marked by movement and mission. Marked by movement and mission. Their prayer wasn't to stay safer inside or to avoid persecution. Again, those were very real threats and they were coming their way, but their prayer wasn't to avoid that. But instead, it was to ask for more and more boldness to go public with this good news of Jesus. It wasn't a prayer that God would move gently in the hearts and kind of under the radar, etc., etc., but actually it was a prayer that He would move in power and miraculous ways in the name of Jesus. There was a sense of movement, there was a sense of growth, of passion, of mission in their prayers, and in a sense, all true mission to God's world should flow from the place of prayer, where we align ourselves with who God is and His heart for the world, and then step out from that place to love and serve whoever and wherever we can. And of course, the great encouragement at the end of this story is that God did hear and respond to their prayers, both immediately in that moment and also in the season thereafter. God shook the place of prayer where this meeting was happening. He literally shook it, it would seem. And I've been in some powerful prayer meetings, as I'm sure you have, as well, but I've never seen the room shaken, not yet anyway. It'd be cool to see it. But God made his power and his presence manifest in a very tangible way. And he also filled these believers with a boldness to speak his word in the season ahead as well, which was the very specific prayer that they had asked him to answer. So as you pray for the Laki of Iran and all the other things that are on your hearts as individuals and as a church this year, may God stir a deeper hunger for prayer in all of you, including myself as well, that we will pray in a more informed and specific way, that we'll be able to increase in our togetherness of prayer, that we will look upon earthly challenges around us in light of the eternal truth of the bigness of who God is, and also that our prayers will lead us to a sense of movement, of mission, and of stretching out our hands and our lives and our hearts to others around us as well. So may God bless you and sustain you in these days and give you his heart as you pray on behalf of the Laki of Iran. God bless you all.
Thank you.
Well, folks, let's pray as we conclude our service together. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for all that our ears have heard this morning, and we thank you for the ongoing work of your gospel through the world. And we praise you, O God, that you are reaching into the nations. And Lord, indeed, on that final day, there will be those from all nations that will be gathered around the throne of God to give you the praise, the honor, and the glory. And Lord, until that time, we pray that you will indeed send others into the great mission fields of the world. And we do pray for the ongoing work amongst the Laki people that we have heard of today. And we pray, O God, for the country of Iran, as we thank you for the church that is growing. And we thank you that the gates of hell will not prevail against the Church of Christ, and that you, Lord, will continue to add to those daily that might and who shall be saved. And Lord, indeed, make us that people of prayer that you want us to be. Conform us more to your will daily, and give us that burden to continue to pray, and indeed to reach out locally where we are in Magheramason and Kilfenan, to reach people all around about us, that we might know a great ingathering of souls locally as well. So we now pray that the love of God and that continued grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit will remain with each and every one who has listened this day, and indeed not just today, but forevermore, until you call or come, Lord Jesus. Amen.
We rest on thee, our shield and our defender. We go not forth alone against the foe. Strong in thy strength, safe in thy keeping tender, we rest on thee. Keeping tender, we rest on thee, and in thy name we go. Yea, in thy name, O captain of salvation, in thy dear name, all other names above. Jesus, our righteousness, our sure foundation, our Prince of glory and our King above. Jesus, our righteousness, our sure foundation, our Prince of from our heart gates of pearly splendor. Victors we rest with thee through endless days. When passing through